will be a similar resource that you can use and adapt for a youth population. This presentation will show you how you can use the justice and mental health system map and companion booklet to develop a more in-depth understanding of how these two systems interact as individuals who work through the criminal justice proceedings. We want you to be able to see how you can use this tool to inform and educate yourself, fellow colleagues, organizational partners, and clients and families that you work with on the complexities of the mental health and criminal justice systems in a visual, sequential, and hopefully very comprehensive way. Our intent with the tool was to be able to provide a picture of what is what a typical individual working through the criminal justice system may face. For those of you that work in one area of the system, the hope is to be able to provide you with a resource that can provide you with background information on the other areas of the system. With that being said, I'll begin by providing a brief overview of CMHA Ontario and the Hjscc network. The justice maps we will be discussing were led by CMHA Ontario, but the Hjscc network played a huge role in creating and finalizing the content, which is why we'll be going over the network a little bit with you today. We'll then look at how the justice systems were created. Sibley will then provide you with an overview of the adult justice and mental health systems map so that you can see how it can be used in understanding how the two systems interact with one another. We'll then provide you with some links and ideas about how the map can be used within your region and community. And then finally, we'll close the presentation with the next steps for this work, including the development of a companion booklet and the creation of a template for local and regional HSJCCs to adapt the booklet to their needs. And finally, we'll open up for discussion questions. We have some guiding questions for you guys to think about, and we're also open to just any general questions you have about the map. So just briefly, CMHA Ontario is pushing to make mental health possible for all. Our work consists of public education, projects looking at systemic issues for the province in terms of mental health, we have 32 branches in Ontario within various communities of the province, which provide direct services to clients, such as counseling, case management, diversion and court support, and health promotion and education. CMHAs in Ontario provide service to about 60,000 Ontarians annually. As a provincial agency, CMHA Ontario leverages the incredible work through different means, such as consultations on specific issues with the branches and quarterly executive director network meetings with the leaders of each branch. So this slide just gives you an overview of all the public policy portfolios that we work on. So I won't go into too much detail about that, but if you visit our website, there's lots of more information on these, such as our public policy work, information on specific projects, as well as programs that we deliver, such as mental health works. And one of the portfolios that you'll see is our criminal justice portfolio, where we work very closely with the Hjscc. So this slide is really just to demonstrate the importance that we emphasize on working with resources was the Hjscc network, of course. You're all very familiar with the mandate and like priority consideration for people with serious mental illness, developmental disability, acquired brain injury, drug and alcohol addiction, and fetal alcohol spectrum disorders. So the Hjscc network has three levels of committees. We have 43 local committees, 14 regional committees, and a provincial committee. They're all voluntary collaborations between many different sectors. So this slide is just an overview of the provincial Hjscc and what that committee looks like. So the regional chairs make up 14 of the positions on that committee. We also work very closely with five ministries as well as partner agencies. In total, there's about 40 people that's on the provincial committee. Okay, so we'll get into the actual map now. So we wanted to be able to provide you with a little bit of background as to why and when this map was created. The first version of the map was created in 2009 for a forensic mental health issue of CMHC Ontario's Network magazine. So Network magazine was written for everyone with an interest or involvement in community mental health. The need for a map to outline the forensic mental health system was determined as something that would be useful for this edition of the magazine. So this is really where the first iteration came from. In 2013, CAMH adopted the map to create a version for youth, which Sibley will touch on a bit later. We also have copies of the map for you if you want to see it, but we won't go into too much detail on that map today. Then in 2014, we updated the adult version of this map for that was originally in the Network magazine. We're now using this map as the basis for the creation of a booklet that goes into more detail on the mental health and criminal justice system in Ontario. We'll go into more detail on the booklet at the end of the presentation. So how we created the map. So when we were updating the map in 2014, we consulted various different stakeholders. There were about 14 individuals from the Hjscc network that provided feedback on the map to ensure accuracy and relevance of the content. We also asked for feedback during the conference in 2013 during a workshop. We brought this map to the Justice Service Collaborative led by CAMH for feedback as well. We hired a graphic designer to help update the images of the map. And they were also translated into French with support from CAMH. So now Sibley is going to take you through the adult map to demonstrate how the map can be used as an educational tool for yourself as well as people.
As you can see, it's a very user-friendly, I think with really great graphics to sort of explain the different stages between police contact and all the way through to reintegration into society and into the community. So I'll go through a piecemeal, but this is how the map looks. This is the youth justice map that Jenna mentioned as well. As you can see, it's similar, but it has its own components that are specific to youth, but it's very similar and just as useful. So we'll start at number one, which is police contact. So this is an important search for police coming into contact with someone who may have mental illness. This is actually a phase where they can divert people out of the criminal justice system if they feel that that's something that is appropriate. And there are new approaches now, as we heard yesterday in the conference, if anybody recalls, it was mentioned about pre-charge diversion, which is operating successfully in some jurisdictions. What that is finding ways to divert the person out of the criminal justice system using the community supports that hopefully that's an issue that's a very live issue right now is that if the resources aren't available, then it's quite difficult to divert people away from the criminal justice system. And but that's the goal, to keep people out of the justice system as a means of helping them with mental illness. But it's something that's available to police and that's being worked on actively, at least in the Toronto area, it's being worked on right now as a viable option, and so it has to be set up properly so that, you know, the community supports are there and that people can be diverted properly. So you'll see at the top the different options, the release for the warning, the pre-charge diversion, and then at the bottom you'll see the supports, the family and community supports, if the person's lucky enough to have family and have caregivers and people in their life that that are supportive, that's obviously a tremendous help at that stage. But so these new approaches to contact with individuals in crisis can make a big difference at this stage and make a big difference ultimately to other sectors and systems and prevent overload in those systems. So if the person is released by police, you'll see at number two. So there's release until first court appearance, and there's also custody. So those are sort of the two avenues that police can take. So if the person's released before their first court appearance, there are needs for support here as well. Between that initial police contact and that first court appearance, that person needs supports, especially if you know they are struggling with mental illness. To be able to make that first court appearance, often people don't show up for that first court appearance if they don't have those supports, and so there is a gap there that's very important to manage. Some people already have their supports. In that case, of course, encouragement to continue to see those supports and to stay stable until that first court appearance is also very important. If they're taken into custody, then they'll access services once they enter into the criminal justice system, and there are services there through the system, and we'll get to that as we go through the map. Now you'll see at the bottom, number B, is emergency department diversion treatment and crisis support services. So that's another potential method of dealing with a person. If police feel that the emergency department is the right place to take them, they will. If they feel that mental health apprehension is necessary, then that's also something they'll do. As we also heard about mobile crisis intervention teams, that's also another avenue that's available now to police, and it's becoming increasingly used and is a very positive development, I would say, in terms of dealing with people in crisis. And so, again, that's another way of alleviating the pressure and the overrepresentation of people with mental illness in the criminal justice system. It's usually not the right place for them, and so these mobile crisis intervention services, such as the COAST program, which I really admire, it's an amazing resource, and I think should be widespread, because it's really a much better solution than sending somebody to custody. Stage, if the person was taken into custody, is the bail stage. So typically a person will, by law, they have to attend court within 24 hours. They have to be seen by a justice within 24 hours of being arrested. So at the bail stage, there are lots of supports in the system. There is a mental health bail program in most jurisdictions. And they will address the person who has mental illness. But everyone is generally involved, and there are mental health support services. The CMHA also provides mental health services. So these resources that are available and that are used. So courts also are able to implement mental health release plans outside of mental health courts, and so this is where it gets a bit sticky in terms of, does the person go to a mental health court or do they stay in the regular stream? And the answer is different in every jurisdiction. Some jurisdictions don't have a specialized mental health court, but even I'll speak to Toronto, which is the jurisdiction I know about. In Toronto, there is a mental health court, but not everyone can go there at the bail stage, especially. They're typically in the regular stream. And if there are fitness issues, then the person could be sent to the mental health court. But I would say that the bulk of people that are in the system who have mental illness are fit, which means that they, are able to, they'd be fit to stand trial. And so, but they have a mental illness. And so, those people will be in the regular stream, but are sort of caught between a rock and a hard place in that sense, because they can't access the mental health court at this stage. At a later stage, if they're released, then they could be able to, but not at this stage. So having said that, we'll just sort of move on to the other methods that a person can be released. So there, I mentioned the mental health bail program. Of course, there's also being released on a person's own recognizance, which can happen, and there's also surety release. And so if somebody does have a surety, someone's lucky enough to have someone come forward for them to sign their bail, this is an important way that that a person can get additional support. So the court typically gives a surety, a lot of agency to help a person. They'll say, you have to sign releases so that this person can monitor your progress. You must attend treatment and counseling, because a person otherwise is not able to be ordered to attend treatment, but through a surety they can be. And so that's a very sort of useful tool that the courts will use to make sure that this person has the supports and make sure that person complies with some sort of a treatment path, if you will. So that's the bail stage. This is speaking to diversion. A very important way of, again, diverting people out of the system so that it's not overloaded with these cases that, as I said earlier, really don't belong there. So that's a very useful way of sort of addressing the issues. And you'll see that the map goes into some detail there about eligible for diversion, not eligible for diversion. So there are policy guidelines that does go to trial, of course, they can be found not guilty or found guilty. They may also be sent for to a psychiatric hospital, or they may be declared not criminally responsible, which is the next stage. If the person is found unfit or criminally responsible, they will go before the Ontario Review Board, and the diagram goes on. Discharge planning and community supports. It's a fluid process, and the goal ultimately is to reintegrate people into society, to have them made whole again, and as much as possible to have them be well and to live well in society as well as they can. And so, so again, community supports are very important here. Is incredibly important at this stage as well. This is an issue that has come up in some other committees that I've been speaking with different stakeholders about, and as many of you may know, working in your respective positions, that supports are very important here. Someone released from a facility, you know, and I was just speaking with a gentleman here in the front row about it, peer supports, which is something that I haven't heard too much about, but I think is incredibly important and valuable. The community supports at this stage are critical, I would say. For example, someone being released from a facility, from a correctional facility, without appropriate clothing, if it's the middle of winter, if it's they don't have even a token to get to where they're going. And same goes from the courthouse. The resources sometimes are not there to get everybody a token, to get everybody the right kind of clothing. They rely heavily typically on the Salvation Army and places like that that have some donated clothing to give to people. And so this is a huge issue actually at this stage, and something that really needs to be worked on, because it's a very, very live issue. The way people are released can set them up for future failure, for breaching. If they've just been given a probation order, if they've just been given some kind of order to do something, the way that the release prevents them from getting to where they need to go, or to get to that shelter, or to get to wherever. So those are really, really important issues, and I'd be happy to hear what you all have to say about it after we finish. Probation officers and how important their job is. They have a very heavy workload, obviously, and are helping a lot of people. But their role is so important. Sometimes they're the only touchstone for people. So you'll see that that's all part of the discharge planning down there, and it shows family and community supports. So well, not everybody has family supports, obviously, but community supports are a huge part of that probation process as well. So that's the end of the map.
Of how the tool can be used to understand each part of the system in a bit more detail. And that's really what we want to get out of this map. So this slide here is just an example of how you can actually use the tool. So the first thing here is obviously you can use it as an educational tool. So on this presentation, there are links to two Prezi presentations. I don't know if anyone has ever used Prezi, but it's just a bit more interactive than the PowerPoints. And I believe all of the slides will be posted on the Hjscc website, so you can get access to these presentations. We also have a few copies here at the front if anyone wants to take a slide deck from today. There's also a link to a webinar that was done on the youth map, so you can look at how that map works. Again, it's through a Prezi presentation. We have that posted, and the actual webinar itself that will walk you through that map. It was done through CMHC Ontario projects on children with complex needs. So that's about an hour and a half webinar, I think, that the link is there. It's also a great knowledge exchange tool that you can use between sectors to ensure a common understanding between service providers and people that you're working with. So I think that's been a common theme coming out of this conference, is that speaking a common language is really crucial to providing good quality service. Finally, the tool is great for system planning, implementation, and doing some gap analysis for local initiatives. So speaking from provincial agencies, it's to categorize the work that we're doing. So with our annual report that was done for the 2014-2015 year, we actually grouped all of the local and regional activities into the three major portions of the map. So we looked at work dealing with police, work in the court system, and then work that's happening corrections or release from custody initiatives that are happening with local and regional communities, and that was a really useful exercise just to get a grasp of what's going on in each of the different parts of the system. In terms of planning, it's also a good starting point for discussions to look at what work local and regional HSJCCs want to do. I think yesterday there was a presentation from the Justice Collaborators at CAMH, and they referenced this tool as something that they use to start discussions and see where the gaps are. It's just something that local HSJCCs can use for sure to help generate that discussion. So the next steps for this map, so there has been HJBC to adapt this tool to their province needs. We're working on companion booklet, so it's not done yet, but the content's almost finished. We need to work with the designer to help integrate some of the images from the map into our booklet. But the booklet that we're developing to provide more details on the map is really based off of an existing booklet that the link is provided here so that you can look at. It was a booklet that was created by the Kitchener local HSJCC that, as Sibley mentioned, it just goes into more detail on what the map does in a fairly sequential and linear way, like the map. So after we've completed the provincial booklet, we want to create templates for local and regional HSJCCs to use in order to adapt it to their needs. So some examples that came out of the Kitchener local HSJCC booklet that has more local and community information that's useful for them. Such as community mental health agencies, hospital programs, outreach programs, that sort of thing. They also have also integrated nicely pictures of actual staff that work in both systems in that booklet, just to give a more localized feel and more friendly approach to working through the system. And they also have a story, much like the provincial booklet will do, that walks through the system with the individual to give it that more narrative feel and make it understandable for everyone that's reading it. So that's really where we're going to go with that. We have some discussion questions that we can think about. We want to know what the strengths and limitations are, if there's any way that you can see this working with the work that you do, how it can help, as well as the companion booklet. So if we can get
lot of questions in terms of the linkages from a community point of view and from a justice. Kids leaving custody, going out, reoffending, becoming part of the adult system. Does it become the new door to walk through, or is there a continuum of services and linkages? So I see the possibility to map to create a discussion, because in a youth size, they don't see systems, they don't see the next. So I like the work. I hope that my encouragement is that piece around transitional age and youth in the justice system is to use the work.
Hi, Lauren Farr from the Royal Ottawa. I just have a question. The maps are absolutely awesome, and I'm just wondering, do they get into the hands of the frontline teams, so the police services, for example, to give to
thank you for that. I'm not familiar with the Toronto South, but it's relatively new, so I apologize for not, speaking to that, but thank you for letting everyone know that's good. I have to say, in the courts, you're right, there is the mental court support workers who are there, but I mean, there are times where the person's released at the end of the day, it's 4:30 or 5 o'clock, those offices are closed. Many times, when I was working in student council, we would be there. Sometimes we have tokens, sometimes we wouldn't.
My name is Jacqueline. I'm with the Canadian Mental Health Association. And yesterday we presented on the respect protocol, which is exactly that. Where, with the transportation program from the OPP, as well as the court worker and the detention center, there's release of an envelope house keys. These take a lot of coordination, and I'm looking, I was hoping the booklet would be all done for me and I could just look at it today, but it's a work in progress. And what I would suggest, because I think many type of initiatives are taking place in different places, and I think comparing the different areas could possibly make it more uniform where these things are accessible for everybody.
Yeah, I agree. I've heard about the Red Envelope program, which is
first do the provincial one and then create the local and regional templates with suggested parts of more localized for example, the Kitchener Hjscc booklet. I encourage you all to get it because it's very good and very good. And they have websites, even program descriptions for their
Courthouse. I do the direct accountability program, so it's a diversion program. We get a lot of people that are denied the mental health diversion, so they go from mental health court into the regular court system, and we don't necessarily have the same tools or connections to the training to work with them all the time. I can't read that far away. So even though the Crown may screen them for mental health diversion, a lot of people get denied it, and then they either end up in our diversion or just a regular court. So it's not just the referral, sometimes they don't fit within that criteria, and then we're not really sure always how to deal with them or what our next steps are. So there is other types of diversions, but will there be information there for people to follow and for us to kind of use to help them when they are kind of pushed out of the mental health court system and into the regular system?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point, and you're quite right that this qualification process is a bit tricky because, first of all, as you say, the resources aren't there to accommodate every single person who may have a mental illness. And as I said, this issue with people who are fit but who are still unwell, you know, being in the general system, that to me is actually the biggest problem the criminal justice system has right now, is that it's people that are not going to qualify for mental health court, they're not going to qualify for these supports and these programs, exactly as you're saying. And even if they did, there aren't enough of you, there aren't enough hours in the day to serve these thousands of people. So, because there are a lot of people who have mental health issues who are absolutely fit and who are not going to qualify for these things. But in my experience, at least in the Toronto courts, a lot of Crowns want to divert people who seem to have a need and who don't seem to be in the right place. They don't want them to be in the system. They don't want them to clog up this and to have the experience any longer than they have to. So that discretion, I think, should be maybe honed in on a bit more. And that maybe that's something that the Attorney General can, focus on, because that discretion is so valuable. And the Crown makes that decision and says, okay, yeah, this person isn't going to make it to mental health court or isn't going to be able to get this diversion. But it's something called informal diversion. So they'll decide what they think, the measure should be. They'll say, okay, can you do this? Can you do this many hours of service? Can you, whatever they think is appropriate, whatever the person can manage, can you go see a doctor in the next week, come back with proof that you've been to the doctor? Whatever measures they think are, agreeable that the person can manage, they'll do it in that fashion. And so that informal diversion can work as well. And that will divert the person out. And so in exchange, if you will, for the person, addressing these issues and doing what they think is appropriate, they will withdraw the charge or they'll stay the charge or whatever they think is appropriate. And so that's another way of doing it, but it's informal. It's a very informal process, and it's based very heavily on who that Crown is. So, and I'm not disparaging anybody. I'm just saying, it could be an education thing, it could be a perspective thing, it could be a lot of different things. And so unless it's built into their policy, it's very tricky to say, how it works across the board.
I'm actually from CMHA Appeal Mental Health and Justice Services. So maybe you and I can talk offline, but I was just going to echo what you just said in regards to the diversion charges. If an individual is deemed inappropriate because there isn't a link with respect to the allegations before the court, we still have the opportunity to provide case management services even over and above. They are on a voluntary basis. So if an individual does want to continue to work with CMHA and the Mental Health and Justice Program, we can certainly advocate in conjunction with the Crown's Office, which I know the team does do. So there could be options there. But if you want to touch base offline, we can certainly chat. Thank you.
Okay. So I just wanted to mention that the booklet, we asked one of our local HSJCs in the North Central area. We actually designed one for our own area as well, using that template. It was a bit of a task, and the group worked on it for a year, but the end result was successful, and what we did is we printed enough so that we could give a copy to all of the service providers in the region, so at least they had that. And plus the map tool you have, we have those as well. Now we basically hand those out to whoever wants one, whether it's a client in the courthouse or an agency that wants to have a bit of a better understanding. So it's a very useful tool for that reason. So just wanted to mention that.
Thank you.
It's good that you're going to have a template, though, because it was a lot of work to try to format that whole book.
Thank you.
I just want to echo that, because I know that in Hamilton, I know I use that navigating the criminal justice system tool quite a lot, especially when you're having the staff that are meeting you and the new staff coming, and you're trying to integrate into the system and learn how to work. So I thought these off the, can you get these off the website?
Yep.
Well, I want to thank Jenna and Sebley for the presentation. And one more.
Just curious and see whether or not your template is, includes glue detectors.
I don't think it does. It's a very good point. It should. No, I don't think it does. I haven't seen it. But you're absolutely right. I think it's tricky. I mean, glad you typically applies in acceptance and friends, but it applies in bail court, it applies throughout. But my concern is with police. I don't know how you can apply at that stage, is what I was going to say. I think that's maybe outside of the scope of the glad you, since it's a criminal court.
When this map was developed, it was really to give a very basic understanding of the connection between the police court and correctional facilities. And so right now, we haven't done a lot of extensive research around the different types of approaches of the different specialized courts that exist. So eventually, Hjscc is just taking an initiative to really investigate that. So there's a court working group right now that's been established.
So you can see by the number of questions and comments, there's a lot of interest in this, sort of navigating through the criminal justice system. So I want to again thank Jenna and Setley for the presentation.